is around the wall and it's right into the corner. With the delivery and the header from Wilkinson. Done ever so well, throws it back, it's been flicked on, and there's Wilkinson. Once it arrived at the feet of Wilkinson via Maddie Cusack, there was only ever one outcome. Outside, good running past Quayle, Raider with a cross, Wilkinson with a header. Katie Wilkinson, powerful and accurate.
Joining us for episode 7 of the Inside the Women's Game podcast. Since launching the show, the response has been great, so thank you for that. This week's show is partner with Coda Independent Sports, an agency involved in the world of sport, music and film. In this week's very special episode, we're joined by a fantastic guest in the shape of Katie Wilkinson of Sheffield United, last season's Player of the Season and Golden Boot winner. Now let's bring Katie in, shall we? Hello, Katie. I hope you're well. Obviously, a massive thank you for taking time out from your schedule to speak to us this week. It's a huge privilege. Firstly, it's a difficult time for everyone, isn't it, at the moment? It's fantastic that the Women's Championship in the WSL is still able to compete at the highest level, given the extent of the pandemic and lockdown and everything else.
Yeah, grateful to still be able to play football. You know, it's a form of outlet for a lot of us, as I guess sport and exercise is for many. And we're kind of the few that get to carry on doing it day in, day out. So massively grateful. And to be honest, I don't know where I'd be without it, I think, during this whole year. So yeah.
So away from the pitch, just what sort of things have you been up to? Do you work alongside football, or what sort of things have you been getting up to? Obviously, the restrictions don't really allow you to do a great deal, do they?
No, I think my lifestyle outside of football hasn't really changed too much, to be fair, bar just less socialising, obviously, because a lot of things are closed and you can't meet up with people. But I have a coffee shop that I manage and run myself, so a lot of my time outside of football goes towards that. So I'm up at, you know, the crack of dawn, and probably most often than not still up at stupid o'clock, kind of doing the necessary that I need for that. So yeah, I've been kept massively busy trying to think outside the box of different things. Obviously, hospitality has been hit probably one of the worst within this pandemic, so it's been a battle to say the least, but we keep going and we don't give up with it. So yeah, that's where my time has been going.
So with the fixture over the weekend with Charlton being postponed to a frozen pitch, that must have been frustrating for you. But let's just take you back to your previous fixture of London Bees in a 4-2 win, getting on the score sheet late on. Just how would you assess that performance overall?
It was a good team performance. I think we got drawn into a bit of a scrap in the second half. Personally, I'd have liked to get a couple more than I did. It's just my own personal standards, I guess. It's good to get one. But like I say, I think I could have had two or three that game. So in that sense, I was a little bit disappointed with my own performance. But it was kind of one of them games where my contribution was probably more, you know, in... other areas than it was in scoring goals. So I'll take that as well.
As you say, though, you set your standards so high, that can only be a good thing. To be disappointed to come off and not have scored two or three, that says a lot about you as a player. Is that something that you've always aspired to do?
Yeah, I think if you set your standards high, then the minimal requirement or expectation that people have of you is met, in my opinion. And it's a weird way to look at it, because you always hit those expectations if they're so high. Maybe not, but for me, I've always kind of had high standards, and I think that's the way to success for me. You have to push yourself and you have to give yourself a challenge, and for me, each season I've done that, and so far it's paying off. So
in terms of the current campaign, especially since the turn of the year, scoring in four consecutive games, two braces and six goals in those four matches. I know you mentioned before that obviously you could have had even more than those goals. That just shows how good you're playing. Just how would you assess the season so far, and especially since the turn of the year?
Yeah, and I think in those four games, I probably could have had one or two more in each of those as well. So imagine where we'd have ended up if that was the case and I'd have scored all of those. But personally, look, I've got goals in terms of, you know, personal achievements that I want to be hitting in terms of goals scored. I'm on track for it, but it could be better, and that's just me as a person. But in terms of the team, for me, you know, promotion was what we wanted, and we're falling short a little bit of that, which I think, to be honest, you look at the league and it's just getting stronger, and you know, We've dropped a couple of points against teams this season that we would have expected to have got all three from. But I think that just goes to show what our attitude is as a team as well. Because, you know, you've got full-time teams all around you. If you look at the table, Durham, Liverpool, Leicester, London City. And, you know, we're sat literally in the middle of all four of those full-time teams. And as a part-time team, you've almost got to give yourself a pat on the back that you're in and amongst that. But for us as a group, we don't want to be sat third. We want to be sat top. So, you know, we're gonna keep going into every single game and trying to get the 3 points and just see where we get to at the end of the season.
Yeah, the league is massively competitive, isn't it? I mean, going into the start of the season, Liverpool were the favourites for the league, and look where they are on the table. That sort of says a lot about how competitive it is. I mean, Lewis got a result at Durham recently. Even those teams at the bottom can still really give you a good game, as you found out with London Bees the other week. That's just how competitive is the league to play in as a whole?
It's getting bigger, it's getting better, which means it's getting more competitive. You know, the analysis that clubs do on each team that they're playing against now is massive, and it's evident because you see teams setting up differently considering who they're going to be playing. And you see that against us. You know, we've come up against Lewis this season where they've, you know, just had two banks of five where they just set up and try and block us from scoring. But I think credit to us this season, we've kind of, you know, it took us a little while at the start of the season to get to grips with the way Neil Redfern wanted us to play. And the same on his part, really, in terms of his personnel, in what positions, in what formation. But we're getting the hang of it now, and the performances that we're putting out, you know, it's just showing that the capability of this group, and hopefully we can, you know, we've got two big games coming up in Durham and Liverpool. Hopefully we can start to do, you know, what we've been doing the last couple of months in those bigger games.
In terms of your form from a personal perspective, you must be delighted with your levels of consistency. Obviously, scoring 15 from 15, that is quite some return. I know you're very modest about the targets you set and everything else, but you must be pleased with that sort of return with the games we've got left to come.
Yeah, but I think the problem is those are my expectations already. So although, you know, I have a lot of people around me telling me how good that is, that's just what I expect of myself. And it's not to say that, you know, I just want the unrealistic side of it all the time, and scoring that many goals isn't always realistic. But actually, if you put your mind to it and you kind of that's your expectation and that's a standard that you want to hit. There's no reason why you can't. And I think for me, you know, the same with last season, I want minimum a goal a game as my average. And if I can hit that, then happy days for me. And, you know, like I say, that's my expectation of myself. And if I can do any better, then I'll be buzzing with it.
Yeah, speaking of that, are you a player that sort of at the start of the season sets yourself a certain amount of goals per season? Or you've got, you scored 14 last season and 15 already this season. You must be happy with the consistency over the last two seasons.
Yeah, I think consistency is massive because it shows that you're good enough, you know, over different challenges, different times, different opposition. So for me, that's massively pleasing that I've done that, you know, over two seasons. But like I say, you know, two goals a game would be great, not just one goal a game as an average. That would be unbelievable. And, you know, that's what some of the things that I strive to do. Not just one goal a game. I want two goals a game. And then if I get two goals a game, I want three goals a game. Do you know what I mean? So there's always more to come. There's always room for improvement. There's always time to learn. And I think that's the thing with me is I don't stop and I won't stop. It's just ingrained in me a little bit. I always want more.
Yeah, it's all about attitude and application, I suppose. Because if you look at the top strikers in world football, their attitude is the same as yours, where you're always wanting, if you score two goals, you want three. If you score three goals, you want four. That's just the attitude that you need to have to be a top-level striker. And let's just talk a bit about last season. Obviously, 14 goals in 15 games, winning player of the season and the golden boot. Obviously, it was disappointing how the season ended prematurely. I know you were disappointed about that. But picking up those accolades, it doesn't really get much better than that, does it, over a season?
No, I mean, personally, you know, you could say that it was, you know, a very, very good season for myself. I think it would have been topped off, like you say, with that winning spot to get that promotion. And, you know, for me, that was probably the sole purpose of that season was to get promoted. So having not done that, obviously disappointing, but to pick up those two accolades, like you say, definitely kind of ease that disappointment and that gutting feeling that we didn't quite manage to do what we'd set out to do.
They're winning those two awards. Did that inspire you? Is that made you even more hungry to score more goals and win the Golden Boot again?
100%. I want it more than ever. I think for me, it's a weird mentality, really. I feel as though if I don't win it again this season, last season's is almost out of the picture now. You kind of, you're in a new season, you know, you're only as good as your last game, as they say, or you're only as good as your last season. Well, we're now in a new season and I want to be winning, you know, I want to be winning those trophies again. So, you know, my passion and my drive is there, similar to what it was last season, if not more so. You know, I've got personal achievements that I want to be hitting and I'll do my utmost to try and achieve them.
Okay, so let's hear more about your story. Obviously, your pathway through football and where it all started. I was going to ask you, does football run your family? But obviously, the reason you got into football was with your twin brother.
Yeah. So I know we had a brief chat about it before, but he kind of was always playing football, always playing with his mates, and I was kind of as the traditional, you know, boys go off and play the football and the girls go off to dancing or to ballet. And it just wasn't a bit of me, really. I begged my mum and my dad just to allow me to go to football just once to see if I enjoyed it with my twin brother, Ben. And eventually they gave in and let me go. And I ended up being one of the better ones there. So, you know, after they kind of saw for themselves how much I loved playing and actually I was surprisingly to them good at it, it just became a thing and I ended up training 2, 3, 4 times a week. And, you know, having a twin brother, you know, you're so close to him, that bond that you have, we just pushed each other every step of the way, whether it be in the back garden, whether it was playing for our local boys team. You know, if I scored 2, he wanted to score 3. You know, the back garden, I remember one time we used to play 1v1s and the garden was quite big, but us just wanting to make the most out of it. We had goals at either end. And the one time And I rarely let my brother win, and not because he wasn't better than me, but just sometimes I wanted it that little bit more. I had that passion and that drive. And the one time he managed to actually score against me, and he was that buzzing that he went off celebrating and went to use the fence as a push off and put his hand through the window and had to go to hospital. Wow. So his celebration of finally scoring against me, he ended up in hospital himself, which, you know, we still laugh about to this day. But yeah, you know, when you've got somebody like that pushing you, there's, you know, that's exactly for me why I have that drive and have that passion and have that competitive edge to me where I always want more, because that's how I grew up. That's how, that's, you know, every single day was the same. So yeah, you know, played with Ben at our local club. He got scouted for Derby. I got scouted for Villa, and we kind of went our separate ways, which was quite sad, really, because I really enjoyed playing with him. But he came and watched me most Saturdays, and then he played every Sunday. So I went and watched him most Sundays, which was nice that we got to watch each other play, give each other a little bit of stick afterwards, a little bit of feedback. You know, if you missed an open goal, you knew about it. And yeah, so, you know, spent most of my time at Aston Villa through the academy, made my way into the first team when I was 16. And I just loved playing. I just loved it. It was all I wanted to do. And got an opportunity to go and play in the WSL when it first started with Birmingham City. Got a bit of Champions League experience and played with some very good players. And being a massive Villa fan, I had to make my way back to Villa after I'd had a bit of an experience there. So went back to Villa. And then I picked up a really bad injury. I snapped 5 ligaments in my foot. In my right foot, my goal scoring foot. And it put me out for about 18 months, which I was gutted because I'd just started that season. We'd had a really good pre-season. And I was banging in goals for fun. I felt fit, I felt sharp. And then in training, I'd gone up for a header, landed on my foot funny, somebody else landed on it. And I'd just snapped pretty much all the ligaments in my foot. 18 months of rehab, getting it stronger, couple of operations, finally made my way back. And it kind of makes you appreciate it a lot more when you spent that time away and you've been told that you might not be able to play football again. It makes you kind of realise just how lucky you are to have the opportunities that I have in football. And I think that's definitely pushed me on a lot. You know, to be told that you won't play football again, to then, you know, a couple of seasons later, winning the Golden Boot, the Championship Player of the Month, Player of the Year, it fills me with a lot of pride. So I think, you know, it makes me more passionate and determined for the game, and I don't think that will ever stop until the day that I have to retire, which I hope isn't for many years to come. But yeah, so that obviously is a massive part of my journey that I think influences me a lot now. So after that, I had to go and play. I'd the management changed at Villa, and it was a hard time for me because I'd been at Villa a long time. The management had changed and they'd kind of not seen what I was about, and coming back from that long out, it was difficult to kind of put my stamp on things a little bit. I needed that time just to get myself back into my rhythm and into my game, but I didn't quite get that belief from the management there that I was good enough to do that. And Luke Swindle-Earse, who was London Bees manager at the time, he said to me, I know what you can do. You've done it. I know what you can do. So he put that belief in me, and it was time for me just to go and play and get back scoring some goals. So I went in the Christmas, halfway through the season, ended up being top goal scorer in those 6 months at London Bees, which was always nice just to do it in half the time. And had another season there, and it didn't quite fit. I'm a bit of a home bird. So living in London, playing in London, I just, that enjoyment wasn't there for me. And for me, enjoyment is massive. If you don't enjoy it, what are you doing it for? And I think you can always tell in players whether they're happy or whether they're not. And for me, I'm definitely a player that, you know, if I'm happy, you don't stop me. If I'm not happy, you'll know, good or bad. So in that sense, you know, I knew that I had to set myself another challenge. I knew that London Bees wasn't the right club for me. And I'd had a couple of calls from different clubs that were interested in me. And I'd spoken to Carla Ward in quite a lot of detail about, you know, what she wanted for the team and what she kind of saw in me that would you know, bring to her team and help them. And I didn't think twice about it. It was something that I knew I wanted to do. It just instantly, I was excited. And I knew it was the move I was going to make. And, you know, we had a really good season. Scored a lot of goals as a team, not just myself. And it was really enjoyable. It was nice to, you know, I felt at home straight away. You know, I've not been at Villa all my life practically. I knew it would be difficult to find a club that you almost feel is home. But at Sheffield, I felt as though it was home straight away. And that's credit to the group of players that were there and the staff. And obviously, still here now, enjoying it and hoping just to keep progressing, really.
Yeah, just taking you back a bit to when you went to Birmingham in the WSL and you mentioned that Champions League experience. Just what did that do for you as a player before returning to Villa? That time at Birmingham, what did that do for you as a kickstart your career, that experience? It must have played a big part.
Yeah, definitely. I think, you know, playing alongside the calibre of players that I was and against, it shows you the standard that you potentially needed to meet, not just in technical ability, but fitness ability, mentality, you know, different coaching styles with Marcus Bignot, which is known as Aston Villa now. But you learn a lot. You learn through different playing with different people, different coaches. And I think it was probably about me maturing at that point. I think it definitely helped me to mature very quickly. You know, I came straight out of academy. I was probably actually within the first team environment back end of 14 years old, 15 years old. So for me, growing up, wasn't necessarily a choice. You just had to do it. You don't just go into the women's game and be able to still act like a kid. You have to grow up quickly and become a woman almost. So I think it definitely matured me and gave me an experience that I can use going forward in terms of, you know, myself, my standards, my expectations and things like that.
Yeah, you mentioned growing up, obviously. Leaving Aston Villa couldn't have been an easy decision to make to move to London, and then obviously moving to Sheffield after that. So, part of being away from your family and friends, was that difficult initially?
It wasn't easy at all. It was, but for me, football is my life. It's, you know, it's what I love doing, and for me, it was the decision that I had to make for myself to get myself, you know, back playing and enjoying football again. And there had to be change to do that. So, you know, at that time, it was the right thing for me to do, but it's important to recognise, you know, over time where you're at. And I think the important thing was recognising that at London Bees, it probably wasn't, you know, it did a job for me to start off with and where I needed to get myself to. But I guess it was a bit of a stepping stone in, you know, coming away from my injury, getting those minutes, getting that confidence back up and scoring goals. And then it puts you back in the picture for other teams potentially to come and take you and get yourself to that level that you want to be, which, you know, when Sheffield got in contact, that's, you know, exactly the type of thing I wanted to happen, so I could go and push myself that bit more.
Yeah, you mentioned that a few teams came in for you after playing for London Bees prior to your move to Sheffield. The way that Sheffield United play, the intensity of their attack, is that something that really stood out for you and played a big part in your move there?
Yeah, I think, you know, the attack, the front three, you know, the midfield that we had, we were just all about scoring goals. I know we conceded a little bit at times, but I think that was due to the nature of how we played. But I think with Wardy, you know, she was an attacking midfielder slash striker herself. So I knew that her mentality and how she played would have come to fruition in how you know, she set up the team and it would be very attacking. And I knew it would suit me. You know, you've got people like Jade Pennant. We had Olivia Ferguson either side of me, who are both very, very good players. And I knew the three of us would be able to, you know, create for all three of us to be getting on the score sheet most weeks. So it was definitely a factor.
In terms of your teammates at the club, the squad is flourish with quality all over the pitch. It seems like a great place to be with some excellent facilities. I know that you and Bex Rayner sort of have a great relationship on the pitch, the way you link up. Bex does a great job down the wing, doesn't she? And you link up really well with her.
Yeah, I think she's football clever, Bex. I think, you know, we probably see passes for each other that not many others might see, and including the defenders on the opposite team. So I think it helps that, you know, we're both on that same wavelength a little bit. And yeah, she's a good player, Beck. She's got some good quality, you know, technically very good. And for me, you know, I need the ball to score. So to have someone like Bex in the team is only going to be positive for me.
Yeah, we mentioned your goal scoring form and the targets you set. Is it good to have healthy competition in the league? Obviously, we've got the likes of Natasha Flynn, we've got Bianca Baptiste, Bridget Galloway, all giving you competition there for the Golden Boot. Is that something that you find positive, that obviously makes you play that bit better to try and score more goals? Or is that something that you don't even think about?
No, it's massive. It's massive. You don't ever want anybody to beat you. And that's the bottom line. So, you know, I hope Tash Flynn keeps scoring, because it only keeps me kind of ticking over and pushing for more goals and more goals. So, you know, you want people around you to be doing their best. And I hope that I'm pushing them to do the same, because at the end of the day, if everyone's pushing themselves to try and be the best, it only makes them better as individuals.
Now, in terms of preparing for a match, is there anything in particular that you focus on prior to a match day?
I'm not really one for kind of similar routines as such. I always have the same pre-match. But in terms of any, you know, weird habits or different things that, you know, in the changing room, I like just to be happy and to enjoy it. And, you know, I've got a little brother, he's 7, he absolutely loves that I play football. He rings me up before every game and tells me how I should score. You know, sometimes he tells me if I've got a free kick that that's what I should be doing and scoring from that, and other times he wants me to score a header. And then he'll always chat to me after the game to see how I've got on, and he's not shy in telling me when I've not scored enough goals as well, which is nice. But he writes me some letters sometimes, which I always keep with me just to remind myself that, you know, a lot of people care about what I do, because I think that's nice sometimes. And little reminders that it's not just you that you're putting on the shirt for, it's your friends, your family, the physios that have got you back from a serious injury. And, you know, sometimes accountability is good, because it makes you work harder. When my motivation might not be as high, there's always everybody else around me that's pushing me to do my best. So,
yeah, you mentioned before about video analysis and stats and stuff like that. Are you a player that looks at data within statistics and video analysis of previous fixtures and stuff, or do you just prepare like you would any other game?
I think analysis is important. I think, one, to reiterate anything that you've done well. I think it's important to be told when you could be doing something better, which I think for me, you know, I like to look at my pass completion and my shots on target and things like that, because for me, that's important as a striker. I think opposition-wise, I like to know, you know, if there's any weaknesses of the opposition. I'm not too bothered about their strengths necessarily as a centre-back. I want to know what their weakness is, and I want to kind of work to that. So that's important to me. But other than that, I'm kind of focused on myself and what I can do each game that makes me a better player.
Now, we mentioned earlier about starting out in the WSL, and they're over the last 3 or 4 years, the standard of the women's game is just getting better and better, isn't it? There's some top players. I know Manchester City are bang on it at the moment in the WSL, along with Chelsea. Frank Kirby playing superbly. Just where do you see the game going in 5, 6 years' time?
The only direction it's going is forward. You know, the money that's going into the game, it's making players better. And that's all you can ask. If every player is getting better, the standard of the league will get better. And it will filter down into the leagues and make it a really good pyramid. So for me, it's going in the right direction. And thank God, to be honest, because it's been a while, hasn't it?
Yeah, in terms of your goal scoring form, Katie, was there a player when you first started out that you looked up to or wanted to aspire to be like in terms of your goal scoring, or are you just your own person?
I loved watching Wayne Rooney. His all round game, his quality on the ball, his attitude. You know, that to me, that's a bit of me. His attitude, his fiery. You know. He just wants to win and win at all costs. And I think that's important because as a sports person, you have to do what you got to do to win. And, you know, the aim of the game is to get 3 points on the board. And however you do that, you know, you do it. So
in any team, I guess it's important to have a laugh and gel as a group. But when it's match day, it's all about obviously focusing and having your serious head on. But do you have a laugh with the girls? Is there any banter in the dressing room? Who's the joker of the dressing room? Who makes you laugh the most?
Yeah, I think, you know, even on a game day, it's good to have banter and have a giggle with the girls. But, you know, we're all kind of in our own right, got something about us that adds to the team. We've got a really, really good group. You know, someone I'm really close with, and I'm the centre-back, you know, we get on like a house on fire. But Leandra Little, she's just, you know, she could be just absolutely minding her own business 1 minute, and then all of a sudden she's in the middle of the changing room, just dancing her way through the changing room and just making the whole team laugh. She's got the ability just to turn a sad dressing room into a really happy one. So I think, you know what, we've got an unbelievable group, not just good players, but good people as well. And we all get on really well. And, you know, behind when that door closes in the changing room, you'll be surprised, you know, what we get up to in terms of getting that music on, having a bit of a party, getting the lights going and just all having a giggle with each other. So I think that's massively important. You know, game day or not, you've got to enjoy it. That's what you're there for.
Now, lastly, Katie, have you set yourself any personal goals for the end of the season? Obviously, we've got a 5-6 week break now. So what will you be doing in that break to try and improve your game, try and improve your sharpness, or what sort of stuff will you be doing?
Yeah, I think it's important to keep yourself ticking over, ready. Obviously, we've got Durham. But for me, you know, it's keeping myself as fit as I can. There's always room to do more. Obviously, I'm always in front of goal, whether that be penalties, free kicks that I'm practicing, shooting from long range, shooting, you know, crossing and finishing. There's everything that you can be doing to improve. So we'll be working hard on the training ground. I personally will be as well. And hopefully we can just, you know, keep ourselves ticking over and be in a good condition to work to play Durham on the 28th of March.
Well, Katie, a massive thanks for coming on the show this week. We've thoroughly enjoyed your company and I wish you all the best for the rest of the season.
Wicked. Thank you very much for having me.